Today we will study about the molecular orbital approach to the coordination compounds, and we also see the molecular orbital diagrams for the coordination compounds besides the molecular orbital theory. So firstly, in order to understand the molecular orbital approach of the coordination compound, we should know the basics of the molecular orbital theory. And I hope you also know that the molecular orbitals are formed by the overlapping of the atomic orbitals that have the matching symmetry and the comparable energy. Such type of atomic orbitals combines, overlaps and forms the molecular orbitals. And when these atomic orbitals wave functions are combined, they generate the equal number of the bonding and the antibonding molecular orbitals. It means the total number of the atomic orbitals and the total number of the molecular orbitals remains same. The bonding molecular orbital is lower in energy, so it is highly stable than the corresponding antibonding molecular orbital. It means the energy of bonding molecular orbital is lower while that of the antibonding molecular orbital is higher. The electrons occupies the molecular orbitals in order of the increasing energy. It means in the accordance of the above principle. So and when the electrons occupies the degenerate molecular orbitals, it means the orbitals that have the similar energy, the electrons occupy separate orbitals with the parallel spins and then they pair up. For example, if we have these orbitals, the electrons will firstly enter in this orbital, then they will pair up, then they will go in this orbital and then pair up, and then these two orbitals are degenerate, they have same energy. So electron will firstly enter with the parallel spin and then the electrons will pair up. Now we see the bond order. The bond order is given by the number of the electrons in the bonding molecular orbital minus the number of the electrons in the antibonding molecular orbitals divided by the 2. And from the bond order, we also understand about the strength of the molecule and also about the magnetic properties of the molecule. Now we see the different abbreviations or the different symbols that are used for the different types of orbitals. In the case of s orbital, there is only one orbital, so it can be said that it is single degenerate. It means there is one probability then the electron will occupy this particular orbital. So it has given the abbreviation A1g. Another is p orbital, because we know there are 3 p orbitals, px, py and pz. So it means the electron can occupy 3 of them. It means it is triply degenerate. So it has given the abbreviation T1u. Another is d orbital, and there are 2 types of d orbitals. First is doubly degenerate 2d orbitals that are same energy, that are dx square minus y square and dz square. So it is doubly degenerate and it has given the abbreviation EG. And another is triply degenerate. It means there are 3 orbitals that will have the same energy, that are dxy, dyz and dxz. So it is triply degenerate and it has given the abbreviation T2G. Now there are 2 symbols. One is G, another is U. What is the meaning of these 2 symbols? These are used for the G rate and the ung rate. Now what is the G rate and ung rate? The molecular orbitals that are centrosymmetric can be classified as the G, it means G rate or ung rate. G implies the wave functions that does not change sign on the inversion through the center of the molecule. It means when we causes the inversion through the center of the molecule and it does not change sign, then such type of wave functions are given the sign G. It means symmetric types of symbol. In general language, we can say it is for the symmetric, while U implies it changes a sign in the case of inversion through the center of the molecule. So U is generally used for the unsymmetrical orbitals. For example, we can see these cases. This is a orbital and you can see when we undergoes the inversion, when we causes the inversion through the center of the molecule in such a direction, you can see this will change the sign. So it has given the abbreviation U. So it is pi U type. Another, this is symmetric, you can see. So it will undergo the inversion without any change in the sign. So it is symmetric and it will be g, and it is especially the pi g orbital. Now this is the orbital. In this case, this is, you can see it is unsymmetric, and when it is in, it undergoes the inversion, that it will go the change in the sign. So it is given the sign sigma u, and another that will not undergo the change in the sign in the case of inversion through the center. So it is symmetric, or it can be said it is sigma g orbital. So I hope you will understand all these types of orbitals. Now we see another term that is important, quite important for the molecular orbital diagrams, that is orbital mixing, because in several cases the orbital mixing takes place. What is it? The orbitals with the similar energy can interact if they have the appropriate symmetries. So in the case of appropriate symmetry orbitals, they will interact with each other and overlap with each other. For example, the sigma 2p and sigma 2s orbitals, these are symmetry related. They have the almost similar symmetry and the similar energy, and they can overlap and give rise to two orbitals, one with the lower energy and one with the higher energy. An example of these types are the case of the oxygen O2, F2 and B2. In these cases, the molecular orbital diagrams are somewhat different. What happens? Suppose these are the energy levels. If we see in the any case of the diatomic molecules, you will see this type of the orbitals. But what happens? This orbital and this orbital will have the similar energy, almost similar energy, and their symmetries properties are also similar, so they can react with each other, they can interact with each other, and the two new orbitals will be formed. It means this orbital will have the higher energy and this will have the lower energy. So in the molecular orbital diagram of oxygen or in the fluorine or in the case of B2, you will see this orbital is found lower in energy and this orbital is found higher in energy. And this affects the arrangement of the electrons, the filling of the electrons. So it will also affect the bond order of the molecule and the magnetic properties of the molecule. Before going to the molecular orbital diagrams for the coordination complexes, we should look at the molecular orbital diagram of the diatomic molecules, especially the homonuclear diatomic molecules, because by this we will get the basic study of the molecular orbitals and their symmetry properties. And this is the molecular orbital diagram for a basic diatomic molecule. It can be any molecule. This is the 2p orbitals diagram, and this is, firstly we start with the 2s orbitals. I have not made here the 1s orbital because it will be same as the 2s orbital, and you can make that below it. Below it we will make the 1s orbital, and I have not make it. You can make it. And this is the 2s orbitals. When two 2s orbitals combines, these are atomic orbitals, when they will combine, then they will form two molecular orbitals. This is the bonding molecular orbital, that is sigma s bonding molecular orbital, and this is the sigma s antibonding molecular orbitals. And you should also put here that this is the atomic orbital and this is atomic orbital, and these are the molecular orbitals. So you should also show them by the labels. And if we see the symmetry properties of this sigma s orbital will be symmetric, and its symmetry will be like this, while the sigma antibonding molecular orbital will be ungiered type and its symmetry will be like that. Next we comes to the p orbital. When two p orbitals of two atomic orbitals combine, then they will forms different types of molecular orbitals. Firstly, the pz orbital, they will combine by the sigma overlapping. It means they will combine directly from the ends of the orbitals, and their overlapping will be type of the sigma. So they will form one sigma pz bonding orbital and the another is sigma pz antibonding molecular orbital, that will be higher in energy. And this is sigma pz antibonding molecular, this is sigma pz bonding molecular orbital, and its symmetry will be g rate type. So it can also be written as sigma g. Another, the two orbitals that are px and py, they will overlap by sidewise overlapping. The px will overlap with the sidewise with px, and py will overlap with another py by sidewise overlapping. So they will form one pi px, another pi py. These two orbitals are degenerate. They will have the same energy. And you can see these are ungerade type. Their symmetry is like this. This is ungerade type. So it can also be written pi u. But these are bonding molecular orbitals. And their symmetry is pi u. And these also form the antibonding. I have said two types of orbitals are formed. One is bonding and another is antibonding. So the antibonding molecular orbitals will be pi px antibonding and pi py antibonding. If we see their symmetries, you can see this is symmetric. So it will be denoted as G rate. So we can also denote them by pi G rate antibonding. They are antibonding and they are G rate type. And now the energy level that is higher in energy, that is sigma pz antibonding molecular orbital. That is formed by the overlapping of two pz orbitals. One was pz bonding and another was pz antibonding. And its symmetry, if you see here, you can see this is unsymmetric, or we can say it is ungerade. So it will be denoted as sigma u antibonding molecular orbital. In the case of the heteronuclear diatomic molecules, the bonding orbital will reside predominantly on the more electronegative atom, while the antibonding molecular orbital will reside predominantly on the less electronegative atom. For example, if we see the case of carbon monoxide, in this case the carbon is less electronegative while the oxygen is more electronegative. So the bonding molecular orbital will reside predominantly on the oxygen, while the antibonding molecular orbital will predominantly reside on the carbon atom. Now we come to the molecular orbital theory or the molecular orbital diagrams for the coordination complexes. In this case, the molecular orbital diagrams are developed with the use of the group theory, because there is a central atom. And when central atom is bonded to several atoms of the same element, the group theory is used to analyze the symmetry of the orbitals on the non-central atom. So firstly, we will have to decide the symmetry of the orbitals according to the group theory of the non-central atoms. That can be any ligand, that is NH3, that may be a H2O, that may be CO, any one. And then they combine them with the appropriate orbital of the central atom. It means we will take the group of these orbitals and then they will combine with the appropriate orbital of the, we will see the symmetry properties of the central atom and that of the ligands, and then they will combine the orbitals of them. And the orbitals of the non-central atoms are also known as the groups orbitals, and we will take them aside. All will take in the group orbitals. Now we see the molecular orbital diagram for the sigma bonded octahedral metal complexes. And I have made this video for all the octahedral metal complexes. It means you can use it as a normal octahedral metal complex. There would be somewhat variations for different complexes, but in the usual, the diagram remains same for almost all types of metal complexes. And in this side, you can see this side are the metal ions that are Mn plus. The metal can be in plus 4 state, plus 3 state, any plus 2 state. So I have taken here a usual case of Mn plus metal ion. And in this side, these are the orbitals of the metal complex, that is of the formula Mn6n plus charge. And in this side, these are the six ligand group orbitals. So firstly, see these, the lowest in the energy, the metal atomic orbitals are the 3D orbitals. And we know that are five orbitals. So I have made here five lines. Then above this, the label of 4s orbital comes, and it is singly degenerate, I have said earlier. So I have here one line is raised. And then above this, the 4p orbital comes. So I have drawn here three lines. And here you can see these are the six ligand sigma orbitals that possess the 12 electrons. Now what happens? There happens the linear combination of these atomic orbitals that will have the appropriate symmetries. As a result of this, different molecular orbitals are formed, and these are arranged according to the increasing energy. It means this will have the lowest energy while this will have the highest energy. So the orbitals are arranged in the order of the increasing energies. Firstly, this is the A1g orbital. It means A1g is the bonding orbital. This is A1g bonding orbital, and that is formed by the combination of the 4s orbital of the metal with the 6 ligand sigma orbitals. Another is the T1u orbital, that is triply degenerate. You can see here three lines. It means it is triply degenerate, and it is formed by the combination of 4p orbital with the 6 ligand sigma orbitals. Next comes Eg orbital, that is bonding orbital, and it is doubly degenerate. So two lines are drawn here, and it is formed by the combination of 3d orbitals with the 6 ligand sigma orbitals. Next come T2g orbital, that is triply degenerate, and that remains non-bonding. After this comes the Eg anti-bonding orbital, that is doubly degenerate. And I have told here that this is the bonding orbital. One bonding orbital forms and another anti-bonding orbital forms. So this is the anti-bonding orbital, and this is non-bonding orbital because it does not take part in the bonding. So it is non-bonding, while this is anti-bonding Eg orbital. Next comes the A1g anti-bonding orbital, that is formed by the combination of 4s and the ligand sigma orbitals. One was the A1g bonding, and another is the A1g anti-bonding orbital. And next comes the highest in the energy is the T1u anti-bonding orbital, and that is also formed by the combination of the 4p and the 6 ligand sigma orbitals. Now we see the case of the B4 orbitals. It means when we see, we can see a simplest case that if the metal possesses the 4 electrons in the d orbitals, that can be shown like this. There are 4 electrons in the d orbital, and I have already said you that the ligand are possessing the 12 electrons. So these 12 electrons will be here. It can be drawn like this. There will be 12 electrons. Now these ligand electrons will occupy these lower levels. This will be predominantly, these levels will be predominantly on the ligands. So these electrons will occupy these levels. One in this one pair, second, third, fourth, fifth and sixth. It means these 12 ligand electrons will occupy these orbitals. Now what happens to these d orbitals of the metals? This will occupy these orbitals. It means that 3 electrons will come into the T2g level, and the 1 electron will come into the Eg level. So you can see that these d electrons come in these levels, and these ligand orbitals comes here. Now we see what is the dd transition. When the electron is excited from T2g level to this Eg level, this is called the DD type of transition, that is DD transition. And what is ligand to metal sigma transition? These are ligand electrons because these are basically on the ligand side. So when the electrons are excited from here to here or from here to here, this will be called ligand to metal charge transitions. And when the electrons are excited from here, from this to this or from this to this, it means the orbitals, these are basically on the metal to the orbitals that are basically on the ligands. Such type of transition will be called metal to ligand charge transfer transition. So I hope you all understand this type of transitions. Now we see the molecular orbital diagram for the tetrahedral complexes. In this case, the diagram almost remains same, but we know that in the case of the tetrahedral complexes, the subscripts G and U is not used. So we will retain these abbreviations like T2 antibonding, A1 antibonding, T2E, A1 bonding, and T2 bonding, etc. So in such manner, these abbreviations will be written. And we know these are the metal orbitals, these are the metal ligand complex orbital, and these are the ligand orbital. In the tetrahedral complexes, there are four ligands. So the complex will be of the type ML4. Now, in this specific case, there are two electrons in the 3D orbitals. So they will occupy the non-bonding E orbital. In this case, the E orbital will be the antibonding, while this T2 orbital will take part in the bonding. And one thing also should be noticed, that in this case, the 4P T2 orbital and the 3D T2 orbitals will have the same symmetry, almost same symmetry, because there is no G or U, G-rayed or un-G-rayed type of subscript is no matter in the tetrahedral complexes. So this will have almost same symmetry, so they can mix. It means there will be the mixing of the orbitals. So this orbital will belong to both the P orbital and to the 3D orbital. So there occurs the orbital mixing in the case of the tetrahedral complexes, and all other things are almost same in this diagram. Since metal 4P orbital and the T2 orbital, metals and 4P, both T2 orbitals are of the same symmetry. So E2 T2 transition in the tetrahedral complexes is less TD type than the T2G to EG transitions in the octahedral complexes. As I have said earlier, that both the metal and the 4P orbitals, both are possessing the T2 orbital, and here the G-rayed and the un-G-rayed terms are not used. So the orbital mixing of their T2 orbital will take place. So now the E2 T2 transition is now not so much DD type, and hence in this case there are these transitions are more allowed, and this occurs at the higher epsilon value. Now we see the variation in the case when the complex possesses the pi acceptor ligands. We know in the case of the octahedral complexes that are sigma bonded, the T2z orbitals remains as the non-bonding orbital. And in the case of the pi acceptor ligands that are CO, carbon monoxide, cyanide ligand, PR3, SR2, or so many ligands that act as the pi acceptor ligands. In all these cases, these possess the T2z orbital that is empty. So they possess the empty T2z orbital of the correct symmetry to overlap with the metal T2z orbital. It means these empty orbital can overlap with the filled T2z orbital of the metal. And this overlapping and the donation of the electron density from the metal T2z orbital to the empty ligand T2z orbital decreases the energy of the non-bonding T2z orbital. It means the energy of the T2z orbital that was non-bonding will be lower as compared to that in the normal complex. Then what happens? The energy of T2z orbital decreases, so it will increase the magnitude of the crystal field splitting. It means Delo value will increase. You can understand it with the help of this a portion of the molecular orbital diagram for the complexes with the pi acceptor ligand. These are the labels in the case of a complex when it possesses only the sigma type of bonding. In this case, this is the EG antibonding orbital, and this is the T2G non-bonding orbital, and this is the gap between them that is called the crystal field splitting energy. This is the crystal field splitting energy between them. Now what happens in the case when there is present the pi acceptor ligands are also present? This will decrease the value of the energy for the T2G orbitals. It means this T2G orbital will decrease in the energy. So this gap will increase. It means the energy of the crystal field splitting will also increase. So these ligands that are the pi acceptor ligands, such as the CO or CN minus Ne, these are called the strong field ligands because they require a high energy for the crystal field splitting or higher energy for electrons to jump from this level to this level. So these ligands are called the strong field ligands, and these forms the low spin type of complexes. Such type of complexes are called low spin complexes, and this is the reason that these ligands stabilizes the metals in the low valency states or zero valency state. Now we see the case of the pi donor ligands. When the complex possesses the pi donor ligands, and the example of such type of ligands are the fluoride ligand, chloride or OR minus. Any of these ligand may be present that act as the pi donor ligand, because in these ligands these possess the filled p orbital when electron density is present in the p orbital, so that they can donate this electron density to the metals empty t2g orbital. It means there may be a type of ligand to metal pi donation in this type of ligands. So in this case, opposite effect will be noticed. What is opposite effect? In this case, this electron density is transferred to the metals higher T2g anti-bonding orbital. This energy is transferred to the anti-bonding T2g orbital of the metal. So it will become the anti-bonding, and it will become in the higher in the energy. And this decreases the value of the crystal field splitting energy. It means the magnitude of the del O will decrease. You can understand the donor behavior, pi donor behavior of the ligands with the help of this diagram. From this diagram you can see this is the metal ligand complex, that is sigma complex. It means when there is no pi donor ligand present. In this case, this is the Eg antibonding level and this is the T2g level that is occupied or that is filled. And this is the energy gap between the two levels. It means that is the crystal field splitting value. Now, when there is a pi donor ligand present that can donate electron density, here are the six ligands. These are the electrons that are present in the pi orbitals, and these electrons will occupy this T2g bonding orbital, while there are electrons in the metal T2g orbital that will occupy the T2g antibonding orbital. So it will raise in the energy, it will go upward. So what happens? This crystal field energy value, this del O value will decrease. You can see this is decreasing. Here it is higher and here it is lower. So del O value is decreasing in the case of the pi donor ligands. So these ligands are also known as the weak field ligands, and this forms the complexes with the high spin. It means such complexes are called high spin type of complexes. So this is all about the molecular orbital approach to the coordination complexes. With the help of this all I have suggested to you, you can make the molecular orbital diagrams for the different complexes. Thank you.